Oh, Kreuz, wo Jesus starb, komm zum Kreuz. Und ihr volles Heiler Gott, komm zum Kreuz. Komme jetzt von Jesu Blut, deiner Seele höchstes Gut, machet allen Schaden gut, komm zum Kreuz. Komm zum Kreuz, wo Jesus starb, wo der Gott, wo der Böse voll und frei, komm zum Kreuz, wo der Gott, wo der Gott, wo der Gott, wo der Gott, alle Herzen machet neu, komm zum Kreuz. Eigentum zu sein, sich des frohen Kindschaftsrechtes zu erfreuen. Darum lasst uns wenden allen Fleiß daran, an den Seelen dieses Heil zu preisen an. Heiland, gib uns einen wahren Rettersinn, seh uns näher, immer näher zu dir hin. Fülle unsere Herzen mit der Liebe dein, lass uns Heiland immer wahre Zeugen sein.
Das teure Blut des Heilands macht mich völlig frei. Wenn der Brand am Wilde geht, Bahn für mich heil. Good morning. We're so glad to have you all here. Whether you're regulars or visitors, we're happy that you came to worship with us. We're all part of the family of God, and so the Bible says where two or three are gathered in His name, there He is. So we're happy to be here. We just ask that you'll stand with us to worship.
That I
Your name is hope inside me, hope inside me.
Thank you, God, for your greatness and your goodness. Let it be the first thing that comes to our mind when we wake up in the morning and the last thing on our mind when we go to sleep at night. When times are hard and when times are painful and when times are good, we want to just focus on your goodness and your greatness. Thank you that you love us. Amen.
Hey, welcome here. You picked a great Sunday to be here. We're going to do things a little bit differently this morning. Okay, normally we're in the middle of our Kingdom of God teaching series. We're going to mix that up a little bit and we're going to shift gears. Before I do that, I know that because of that, we've got some guests in our audience this morning. I just want to say welcome here. We love having you in our midst. We hope that you feel accepted and like you belong here. Everybody belongs here. If you want, we'd love to just give you a gift as part of our hospitality and say we love having you with us. You can just go to our welcome center that's in the foyer. It's up against the wall, and they're going to give you a gift bag there. If you're brave and you want to introduce yourself to us, you can fill out that welcome card that's in the pew in front of you. It's that yellow card. We just want to say hi, so if you're feeling brave, do that. You can put that in the offering or bring that in to the welcome center with you as well. So this morning, we want to do something that we call the gift of honor. And we're just celebrating the fact that we are an intergenerational church, and we really love that. We've got people here who are 100 days old, and we have people here who are 100 years old, and we're all gathering in the same place, and we call ourselves family, and we've got a common purpose and mission that unites us. We have a God that unites us. And so we love seeing community form across generations. We love seeing those relational bridges being built in lots of different ways that happen. We love it that that's part of who we are as WMBC. And so we love all generations. We love investing in the younger generation. We love honoring the older generation. And that's what we want to do here this morning, is we are celebrating and honoring our boomer crowd and above, okay? That's what we're doing here this morning. We love having you with us and part of our family. So there's a few things that we're going to do differently this morning. One, we're going to bring back what was a part of the church experience for an older generation. We are bringing back the church choir for today. Okay, yeah, there we go. Very exciting, I know. I won't be in it, but other people will be up here singing. So we're going to do that really soon. Also, we're excited that this year we have got someone in our midst who really is turning 100 years old, and that is Justina Wiebe. And I believe, where? There she is, Justina. We are. So let's give her a round of applause. Hey, there we go. Oh, that's so good, Justina. A big surprise, yeah, that's right. We've been planning this for a while, and we're glad this is a surprise for you. So we love having you as part of our family, and we've actually got one of your former students that's going to share a tribute to you later this morning. Dorothy Plett's going to come up. So we're going to do that in a little bit, okay? Thank you, Justina. I'm going to pray for us here this morning, and then I'm going to invite Dorothy to come on up. Let's pray. Jesus, thanks for being with us in our midst here. You're the one who unites us, who gives us common ground, who makes us a family. That's fantastic. God, I pray that you just continue to build into this community right here so that when we're here, when we're gathered, and even when we're scattered, we know that we have a family, and you're our Father. And so I pray that you just keep building that sense and that sense of community and family in our midst. God, we're grateful for all the generations that are present. We're grateful for the new babies that are showing up all the time, our teenagers, our kids, our young adults, our middle age. We're so grateful that we've got the whole span. And today we really want to say thank you for all the gray hairs in our midst, Father, or the lack of hairs in our midst. We're so grateful for their experience, their presence, their life with you. God, their unique voice in our community, they add so much value to who we are, and we're grateful that they're part of us. And so I pray that they feel celebrated this morning and continue to feel like they're accepted and they belong here. Father, special thanks for Justina. We think it's so great that she's been with us for so long and is still a vibrant influence and presence here. We love her. We know that you love her. We pray that she feels valued today. Jesus, we're here because of you. Amen. Okay, Dorothy Plett, a former student of Justina, is going to come share a few memories that she has. Please help me welcome her to the stage.
Good morning. It's good to be here. Yes, I will play a little bit of the Mennonite game thing. I used to be a Peters. Well, there's still Peters in me, a lot of Peters in me. My parents are John M. and Lena Peters. I have three brothers, James, JC, and a lesser-known brother, Lawrence. And I'm here representing my mother and I. We have been asked to give a tribute to Justina Wiebe and the life she has lived thus far over the last 100 years, a century. Wow. We have both been greatly influenced by Justina Wiebe. My mother's history with her, of course, goes back a lot further than mine does. But interestingly enough, there are a lot of similarities in our stories. As Mom and I talked about our memories, it was evident that Mrs. Wiebe was and still is an encourager. She encouraged my mom in the early years to begin singing solos, and if I remember correctly, she also gave me my first solo in church. Just this past December, a group of us gave a Christmas program at the Bueller Active Living Center, and I sang a couple of solos there. It was a pleasure to sing for her again, and she always shows such great appreciation. A few years ago, we had a similar program, but I stumbled in my presentation and felt quite humbled. But she encouraged me afterwards, not negating that stumble, but feeling with me with very supportive words. To say that singing was important in her life would be an understatement. She sang when given the opportunity. She conducted adult choir and children's choir. She gave voice lessons and coaching when it was needed. She expected excellence, but taught the context of the words. It was all done with an attitude of doing it for the Lord. That was what made the greatest impression on me. As many of us here have a similar background, choir practice on Saturday evening back in the day was a social event. It was as important as checking your Facebook or Twitter account is now. It was a family time. Mom, Dad, my three brothers, we all sang in the choir. In fact, there were times I even remember sitting in the choir loft with Mom when I was too little and had no one else to supervise me in church. I want to take this opportunity to thank Pete Wiebe for directing this choir today, and the organizers for giving us the opportunity to relive this experience. As we practiced yesterday evening, feelings of nostalgia were very evident, at least to me. And the message was the same then as it is today, praising our Lord together in a unique and powerful way. Mrs. Wiebe always guided us to singing the words of the music with great expression. If my mind's eye could be a YouTube video of what I can still see, you would have a real-life picture of Mrs. Wiebe's style of conducting and how she could almost pull the expression out of your innermost soul. And I've talked to some people and they remember that. We learned to appreciate a lot of choral music under her direction, and I thank her for that. Even after she retired from directing church choirs, she sang in the seniors' choir with my mom. They spent many happy years experiencing this together. Mom says that her friendship always meant a lot to her. They would talk on the phone from time to time and always have a good chat. There was also a group of men and women from this church that would provide a church service at Salem Home once a month. Mrs. Wiebe and both of my parents were part of that for many years. This group, although the members have changed, still provides this service once a month. Ironically, I actually sing in that group. My appreciation for Mrs. Wiebe has gone even deeper as I now know from personal experience what her involvement in the Winkler Festival of the Arts has meant to many in the community over the years. And you saw a number of pictures on the screen before of trophies that they'd won and that sort of thing. I have been the president over the past few years and know the organization that goes into such an event. She was involved with this for many years. I did some digging and found her name as one of the vocal conveners as early as 1954 and as late as 1980. Currently, we have a trophy that she donated for the best vocal performer that has been in circulation from 1993 and is still being awarded each year. In conclusion, I just want to say, Mrs. Wiebe, you have been a true inspiration to many people, including both my mom and I. Your walk with God was and still is evident. In honor of your 100th birthday, I want to leave you with Psalm 100, which I think is very fitting. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations.
While they assemble back there, let me just introduce these two songs. We're talking about seniors today and a legacy not only of Justina Wiebe, but all the seniors in this congregation. I guess I'm getting close there too. Not quite as old as this first song, 2,500 years ago, David wrote a very famous or well-known psalm, talking about still waters and green pastures and also walking through Valley of Shadow of Death. He fought lions and bears and Goliath, an angry king, and was a man after God's own heart, but also had his own struggles. 200 years ago, Horatio Spafford was crossing the ocean. He crossed the place where just a few months before his four daughters had drowned in a horrible shipping accident. As he crossed that spot in the Atlantic Ocean, he wrote, "When peace like a river attends my way, or when sorrows like sea billows roll, God has taught us to say, it's well with my soul." It's a legacy that many seniors in this church have left us, are still leading for us, and which we aspire to.
Thank you. All right. Well, not bad for one practice. There we go. So, Justina, we want to thank you so much for serving and blessing our church family all these years. You know, music touches our hearts, and it's such a beautiful pathway to connect to God, and you have led us down that path. We want to recognize you for having a significant role in just leading us to passionately love and follow Jesus. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 31 reads, "Gray hair is a crown of glory. It is gained by living a godly life." And Justina, you have modeled for us a life lived for the kingdom. Thank you for never losing that sparkle in your eye. And on a personal note, what a joy it has been to be your pastor. You've become like another grandma for my girls, and especially for Neve. So from all of us here at WMBC, we love you, and we want to thank you for serving us all these years. Thank you, Justina. You're welcome. There we go. Well, that was fun, right? I don't know if you saw on Pembina Valley Online, there's this great story of Abe and Elsie Suderman on Pembina Valley Online, how Abe kind of was part of fighting the fire, Winkler fire back in 1961. Abe, just, you guys are back there. We want to recognize you, too, just for all the great years that you've served us as fire chief. So thank you very much as well. You should see him in his uniform. He looks pretty sharp. There we go. Well, this morning we are talking about giving the gift of honor. And in particular, how do we give the gift of honor to the older generation? And in case you're not sure if you qualify as being old or not, you might want to ask yourself if any of these signs are true of you. You're getting old when the gleam in your eyes is from the sun hitting your bifocals. You sit in a rocking chair and you can't get it going. Your knees buckle and your belt won't. You might be getting old if your back goes out more than you do. The little old gray-haired lady that you helped across the street is your wife. Yeah, just careful with that one, right? Yeah. You may be getting old if you've dreamed of prunes. If your ears are hairier than your head. And you know all the answers, but nobody asks you the questions. You know all the answers, but nobody asks you the questions. That kind of actually rings true in our culture, perhaps in the church. Right? Have we foolishly neglected the wisdom of older adults? Wisdom that can only be had living through stuff. The term ageism was first used by Robert Butler in 1969 to describe the discrimination of older adults. And that many fear that that's not only crept into our kind of our medical fields, our mental health fields, but perhaps it's crept into the church as well. One of the recent articles in the magazine Christianity Today was titled, "Your Church Needs Boomers: How a Hyper-Focus on Attracting the Young Can Sideline the Aging Faithful." Quote, "Some churches have paid so much attention to attracting the young that they are overlooking the needs of the seniors in their midst. Some pastors view seniors as an uninspiring but necessary part of the ministry, except when it comes to their money, financial portfolio, or living trust." Ouch. Many are beginning to wonder if churches are building an institution that subordinates a group of people on the basis of their age, right? Boasting new models of doing church, leaving older adults as these rusting obstacles in the way, blocking growth. Is that WMBC? I think some of you would say yes. Right, as we spent time prioritizing listening this year, some of you that make up kind of the older demographic, you haven't been satisfied with your experience of community here at WMBC. Some of you perhaps feel ignored or marginalized or patronized. You know, we've talked lots about the younger generation walking away from church and from faith. But recent studies also show that nearly half of unchurched Christians, those who love Jesus but not the church, 44% are between the ages of 55 and 75. At WMBC, yes, we do value and focus on reaching young families, and that is a good thing. But that desire isn't healthy if it doesn't also include a desire just to have a diversity of ages and all of life stages reflected in what it means to be a spiritual family. We are incredibly blessed here at WMBC just to have all the ages represented. God's household is the very definition of church. We're not like a family, we are one. We're not like a family, we are one. Now, the word disciple, so prevalent in the early part of the New Testament, it disappears after the book of Acts. It's replaced by the terms kind of brothers and sisters in the rest of the Bible. Family dominates the self-understanding of the early church. Now, we dream of being a church that young people increasingly discover and love and find just an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. But we don't want to leave any other generation behind. My dream that for WMBC as a community that focuses on the gospel and Jesus would be a refuge for all ages. In a culture that is fractured and divided, a church that can function as an intergenerational family is a radical and beautiful witness. It's a story that would change the perception of church. And if we want that to be our story, and we do, well, then we need to learn how to give the gift of honor. R.C. Sproul once wrote, "When I last crossed a decade barrier in my own aging process, God was good enough to grant me this small bit of wisdom. The Bible honors age, not youth. I came to understand that the disappearance of my youth was something that God thought of as a good thing. And if I were wise, I would agree. Now, a decade later, and I have been given this bit of wisdom, easier said than done." As my brother-in-law's mother once said, growing old is not for sissies. Growing old is hard. And a lack of respect and honor towards the older generation has always been a fundamental problem. That's why God addressed it thousands of years ago, kind of giving us a law. So if you go right back to the beginning of the Bible, Leviticus 19:32, we read, "Stand up in the presence of the elderly and show respect for the aged. Fear your God, I am the Lord." Right? Notice the connection between honoring our elders and honoring God. And Jesus actually teaches the same thing. Open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 15. We're going to look at a conversation that Jesus has with the religious. Matthew chapter 15, turn in or turn on your Bibles there. And I'm going to start in verse 1. "Some Pharisees and teachers of religious law now arrived from Jerusalem to see Jesus. And so they asked him, 'Why do your disciples disobey our age-old tradition? For they ignore our tradition of ceremonial hand-washing before they eat.' Well, Jesus replied, 'And why do you, by your traditions, violate the direct commandments of God?'" Jesus comes right back at them. "For instance," Jesus says, "God says, 'Honor your father and mother, and anyone who speaks disrespectfully of father or mother must be put to death.' But you say it's all right for people to say to their parents, 'Sorry, I can't help you, for I have vowed to give to God what I would have given to you.' In this way, you say that they don't need to honor their parents." Now pause, just a quick bit of context here. Remember, in ancient culture, there were no government programs. There's no old age pension. I mean, you relied on your kids to provide for you as you got older. But some of the Jewish people in Jesus' day, they were getting around that through a religious loophole, something called Corban, where you would make this declaration or vow that all your possessions, all your savings, they were a gift to God, dedicated to God, which means that these resources now were unavailable to anyone else. So R.T. France writes, this convenient declaration apparently left the property actually still at the disposal of the one who made the vow, but deprived their parents of any right to it. So you see, through this loophole, they could disobey the command to honor their parents while being ultra-religious at the same time. Jesus says, you hypocrites. Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you, for he wrote, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce, for they teach man-made ideas as commands from God. To honor your parents, to honor the aged, is to reveal, Jesus says, your heart's posture toward God. To give the gift of honor is actually an act of worship to God. It pleases God to honor the elderly. This conversation also reveals that the gift of honor is not only to show respect or in submission, but to honor goes beyond words. It's an act of provision. It's to nourish and support and to enrich their lives. So we've learned that to give the gift of honor to the aged, it's a countercultural witness. It's an act of worship, a way to honor God. And then thirdly, it's for our good. It's for our benefit, for the church. The church needs the wisdom and spiritual maturity that comes from evaluated experience as we age. We read in Job chapter 12, verse 12, wisdom belongs to the aged and understanding to the old. Now, biologically, most humans, our human functions, they peak in our early 20s. Sorry, yeah, right, that's great. Real pick me up there. But when you're 40, you still retain most of your strength, your energy, your vigor, but now you've learned all this, you know, skill and wisdom through experience. They call that old man strength, right? Don't arm wrestle your dad when he's in his 40s and his 50s. But then we face a crisis. Our physical strength, our stamina, our health begins to deteriorate. Like, is that the trajectory of our lives? That it all goes into this pathetic crash at the end. It's all downhill after 40. But the Bible says otherwise. This is what we read in Psalm 92. Psalm 92, starting in verse 12. But the godly will flourish like palm trees and grow strong like the cedars of Lebanon, for they are transplanted to the Lord's own house. They flourish in the courts of our God. Even in old age, they will still produce fruit. They will remain vital and green. Boy, when I read that, I thought to myself, that sounds a lot like Justina. The truth is that as we age, if we're willing to seize the opportunities to grow from our experiences, to evaluate, our ability to impact, it doesn't deteriorate like our biological era. It continues to grow. We continue to have further impact for the kingdom and our ability to influence others because we've gained all this wisdom and understanding. WMBC needs to desperately engage the older generations because they can make some of the biggest impact for the kingdom. Acts 2:17, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. And your old men will dream dreams. Oh, we need the dreams of the older generation. We believe that God speaks to you and speaks through you. If we want to be a spirit-led at WMBC, and we do, we need to hear the dreams of our older adults. God intended the young and the old to form a sort of symbiotic relationship. The Apostle Peter, in his first letter, he writes and gives advice on the relationship between the elders of the church and the younger generation. Now, to be clear, Peter's writing to elders, not to the elderly, but if you give me a little bit of leeway, and we think of this as how does this relationship between the older generations and the younger generations work, I think there's a principle here that just applies to our discussion. Go with me, if you want, to 1 Peter chapter 5. It's almost all the way to the end. 1 Peter chapter 5, I'm going to start in verse 1, and the words will be on the screen. "And now, a word to you who are elders in the churches," Peter writes. "I too am an elder and a witness to the sufferings of Christ, and I too will share in his glory when he is revealed to the whole world. As a fellow elder, I appeal to you." To the older generation, I appeal to you. "Care for the flock that God has entrusted to you. Watch over it willingly, not grudgingly, not for what you'll get out of it, but because you are eager to serve God. Don't lord it over the people as assigned to your care, but lead them by your own good example. And when the great shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of never-ending glory and honor. In the same way, you who are of the younger generation, accept the authority of the elders, and all of you, young and old, all of you, young and old, dress yourselves in humility as you relate to one another. For God opposes the proud, gives grace to the humble. So humble yourselves under the mighty power of God, and at the right time, he will lift you up in honor." Right? As we humbly serve each other, as we put each other first, as we work together, the wisdom of the old combined with the energy of the young, the entire church family is lifted in honor, Peter writes. So I want to close by giving us some practical next steps, some ways that we can work at doing that, and at WMBC to give the gift of honor as a church family, particularly to the older generation. So number one, you know, if you don't know where to start, start with mom and dad. Honor your father and mother. Let me suggest a couple of things. First, as Jesus taught in Matthew 15, as children of elderly parents, we are called to provide for them, to support for them, not only financially, but just hands-on loving care. Secondly, forgive them. There are no perfect parents. Your parents have made unwise decisions. They have said things and done things that have wounded us. Our parents have sinned against us. Jesus calls us to forgive them. And we can only do this through the gospel, through Jesus. As we accept the grace and the forgiveness that God has shown us through his son Jesus, so now we extend that grace and forgiveness to our parents. We forgive you. And we honor them. Number two, we just need to be quiet. Talk less, listen more. We need to hear the wisdom and understanding of those who have more years of life experience than us. We just need to listen more. So think about that in your own life. Who are the older adults in your life, and what does it look like for you to actually go out of your way to intentionally listen to them? What stories would you want to hear? What questions would you want to ask them? Mom, how do you make your buns, right? We can give the aged dignity and respect and the gift of honor through relational listening. And number three, celebrate those who are older. We just need to celebrate more. Now, back in November, a group of around 20 of us went to Turtle Island Community Church. It's a First Nations community that we support and partner with in the inner city. And we got to go around Christmas time just to help them put on a meal for the community. And it was more people than they've ever had before. I think we served over 350 people. And it was in a gym. It was chaotic. There was not enough chairs for everybody. But I think something left a lasting impact on me, and I think for the rest of the group as well, because we got to see firsthand what it looked like in First Nations culture to honor your elders. the elders ate first, right? And yeah, it got complicated, and we weren't always sure who would, but everyone there knew, all people there, they would go, you should serve them first. It was a beautiful thing to witness, a community sacrifice, and to acknowledge the older generation instead of a place of honor and celebration. You know, and I think in our Western culture, we have things to learn, right? We fear aging. We view it as this shameful experience, and so we do everything we can to fight it. And we have much to learn of how to celebrate growing old and to honor the older generations. So on that note, one of the ways that we wanted to celebrate Justina today and to share her gift of music is what we've done is we've taken this this record that Justina directed and recorded back on September 9th, 1979. It's an album of German hymns. And so we've taken that, and with the amazing technology that we've had, we turned it into a CD. And I like this. It looks like a little record, all right? So, we want to just honor the older generations. This is a beautiful tribute to Justina with her music, some beautiful solos. You'll kind of hear as we end the service a Justina solo if you stick around. So we have this. If you would like this, this is a gift to you, for you. And so please pick one up. If you would like... if you're like, well, I don't know if I want to have a CD of German hymnals, but I know somebody who does, you can also just, we want to equip you to give the gift of honor to someone in your life. So please take one. Now, here's the thing. They are going like hotcakes, all right? So we may run out. So if you want one, we'll make more. We can do that. We'd love to do that. So just, there'll probably be a paper there. If we run out, just sign your name and email, and then we'll get this to you. So that's good. At being family here at WMBC, how can we do, right? How do we give the gift of honor? How do we humbly try to put each other first? Let's honor and celebrate just the many generations that we have. I would love your help. I would love your help in visiting and caring for our seniors. I actually need your help as pastor. If you are interested in serving our church, essentially to kind of do what deacons in the Bible did, right, to serve the widows, the poor, the sick, please come and talk to me, right? This is a community responsibility that we have to care for our seniors, to care for our moms and dads. Because we're not like a family, we are a family. Now, we're going to sing our prayer to close out. So we're going to sing the doxology together. How was the pitch the first time around? Was that okay? Well, just a little lower? Okay. Does someone else want to start? Where's Dorothy? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Thank you, Justina. We love you. We're going to have people here to pray with anyone that needs prayer at the end. The CDs are there to pick up if you want. Thank you for joining us. We're going to resume our Kingdom series next Sunday. God bless.